Thank you, Dr. Anaga. At the outset, I would like to thank Anaga and AIOS for inviting me here for this talk. Today's my talk is going to be phaco after vitrectomy and pearls for the cataract surgeon. There are expanding indications for past planar vitrectomy. Previously, before 23 and 25 and 27 gauge vitrectomy came up, we would be scared doing a vitrectomy. Today, for almost every patient with a dermatogenous retinal detachment, I would do a vitrectomy as a procedure of choice. PDRs we have begun tackling much earlier, macular holes and epithelial membranes, trauma or vitreous hemorrhage. Now, one of the most common complications is cataract, which develops and progresses in up to 70% of patients within 2 years after surgery, after the past planar vitrectomy. The risk factors are old age, pre-existing sclerosis, silicone oil tamponade or long-term gas, and lens touch. The types of cataract which are there are slightly different from the normal senile cataract. You can have a dense nuclear sclerotic cataract. The nucleus is extremely hard, and Dr. Sandeep will tell us about how we do we tackle this. You can have a posterior subcapsular cataract because that's the place where the oil or the gas comes in touch with the posterior capsule. More importantly, you can have posterior capsular plaques, and you can have mature cataract. Remember, if you have a mature cataract after a past planar vitrectomy, always suspect a lens touch. Now, why is phaco challenging? Because there's a higher risk of intra and post-operative complications. The original disease gives less vision to the patient and can flare up after the cataract surgery. The complications of past planar vitrectomy procedure also can be there, which could complicate the procedure. And the most important thing is that there's a lack of vitreous support, because that's the bounce on which you do your phaco, which we don't realize unless you do a patient who's in whom a vitrectomy has been done. There is conjunctival scarring. So in these patients, it's better to avoid a sponsorship cataract surgery and go ahead with the phaco emulsification. You can do the cornea, maybe having a compromised corneal endothelium. Now, when the patient comes to you, the patient might have had a silicone oil removal. And what happens now is that there could have been silicone oil in the anterior chamber previously, which has led to a reduced endothelial count. And now the patient might have problems because of that. There can be poor pupillary dilatation, zonular weakness or a pre-existing rent, low scleral rigidity, and an increased lens, iris, diaphragm retropulsion. So when you keep your bottle height up, the lens, iris, diaphragm tends to keep on swinging. It goes down and comes up as the phaco progresses. Now, what are the pre-op factors which one needs to look after? You have to ask the patient a history and check the previous surgeon notes, because in that it would have been written whether gas was used, oil was used, how much of a vitrectomy was done, and what was the vision of the patient. Biometry is extremely important. You have to assess the need for cataract surgery, because many of these patients have a pre-existing retinal disease and subtle amounts of nuclear sclerosis may be missed, and doing the cataract surgery in these patients may improve the vision dramatically. You have to prepare the patient and the relative for possible complications and take a very good informed consent, because this is not like your routine cataract surgery. Biometry or optical biometry is always preferable. You can have presence of myopia and a posterior staphyloma, especially in patients who have undergone LASIK, and then you need to factor in the LASIK calculations also. In patients with silicone oil, the biometry is extremely confusing. You can do it in a sitting position, and you can do a correction for axial length. But many people believe that it's very difficult to get an exact axial length with a silicone oil. So what is my preference of choice in these kind of patients is that if the patient is phakic, once I put the oil, I send the patient for biometry about a month down the line when the cataract is still clear. So I have some reading with me to go by. And with this optical biometry, you can get a very good reading. And then later on, whenever you decide to do the cataract surgery, you can do a repeat biometry and use the first reading also, and then judge as to what lens you want to put. Assessing the need for cataract surgery is very important in these patients. You have to review old medical records. Carefully monitor the visual changes. If you or some of your colleagues have a potential acuity meter, you can use that. And remember, try to do an OCT. Even if it's a hazy media, even if you're getting just one line of OCT, it can tell you whether the retina is attached or detached. It can also tell you whether there's macular edema or no, because that is going to change the prognosis. Now, preparing for possible complications and consent. You have to talk to the patient. You have to explain to them that there can be zonular instability, phacodonesis. There can be posterior capsular compromise. You have to modify the techniques and keep the instrumentation ready. Inform your vitreoretinal colleague. Be sure to do this surgery when your vitreoretinal colleague is in town and not when he is away to AIOS for the conference. Explain to the patient and the relatives the higher degree of risk that is there. Now, what about intraoperative factors? It is preferable to do topical anesthesia because these patients may have a posterior staphyloma. But in case you're expecting a long surgery or you're expecting a complicated surgery, then it's preferable to give a block. Wound construction, you should avoid areas of conjunctival scarring. The clear corneal wounds are better, and you have to have a little longer wounds due to the possibility of postoperative hypotony. Also, it's better to, at the end of surgery, to suture up these wounds. Capsular access can be very difficult because you have a poor red reflex. You have a lack of posterior support, and hence you tend to exert a greater pressure over there. There can be anterior capsular fibrosis, and hence you must keep your Rexis forceps and scissors ready in order to cut the capsule if required. And if you have doubt, it's always better to stain the capsule rather than trying to work on the red glow. Hydrodissection has to be slow and gentle and at multiple points, and you must allow the fluid to egress out so that you don't create too much of pressure on the posterior capsule or the zonules. When you're doing phacoemulsification, it's important to remember that you must keep a deep and you must keep a stable anterior chamber. You should avoid deep and unstable anterior chambers. There can sometimes be fluid misdirection, and the fluid can go through the zonules, go behind, and increase the eye pressure. In such cases, what you can do is take a 30-gauge needle, go in through the pars plena, and slightly aspirate the fluid. The pressure comes down, and you can proceed ahead with the surgery. There has to be minimal movement of instruments, avoid slipping of the cortex, and we will talk about posterior plaque handling a little bit later. You have to decide which IOL you're going to put, so keep all IOLs ready. Keep a single piece for in the bag ready, keep the three-piece ready for in the sulcus implantation, and you should also keep an iris claw, a stellar fixated or a glued IOL ready, and you should avoid silicone IOLs because silicone oil tends to react with the silicone IOLs and gives opacification. Now here's a patient with a dense posterior capsular plaque. You can see that there are various sinica over here, there's some amount of emulsified oil over here. Now this patient has pre-existing silicone oil in the eye, and sometimes these bubbles can come up through the zonules and can complicate the procedure. Hence, it's very important to always keep the anterior chamber filled with viscoelastic. Now here with the hydrodissection, with the cannula, we're just going and separating the posterior sinica. And once these posterior sinica are separated, there's adequate dilatation over here to go ahead with the capsular access. Once the cataract surgery is done, you can see here that there's a dense posterior capsular plaque. Now this posterior capsular plaque is different from the one which Sir showed. Sir's posterior capsular plaque originates from inside the lens and it's stuck onto the posterior capsule. This posterior capsular plaque originates from behind because that's the place where the silicone oil or the gas comes in contact. And it's very difficult to remove this. So what I prefer to do is leave the posterior capsular plaque in place in this case because there's silicone oil inside. And later, 3 to 6 months, or maybe not even three, a couple of 1 or 2 months down the line, once everything has fused off, do a small Rexis with a YAG laser. Just do a small opening over there so that you can see the retina very well. Sometimes if the silicone oil is not there, then you can go in with a cutter and cut this, make a small opening in the, and cut this plaque over there. This is another case which is there in which, look at this. This is the mature cataract. Now look at these two vertical lines over here. You can see those two vertical lines going down. Now, as the phaco progresses, remember, mature cataract means that there could have been a lens touch. So this patient had undergone ultrasound before, retina was attached. Here you see that the capsule is torn over here because there was a lens touch, and the moment the hydrodissection was done, it opened up completely. So at the same sitting, I decided to go in, attach retina. I think I'm just going to remove the nuclear fragments. I'm removing them over here with the cutter itself. And as the vitrectomy progresses, you see that there is a superior retinal detachment over here, which has just happened. So these surgeries can be extremely unpredictable. And hence, in the postoperative management, one must be very careful. You can have higher incidence of IOP spikes and hypotony. You can have anterior migration of silicone oil. Now what happens is that even after the surgery, some of the oil can go out through the zonules and become loculated under the iris. And here you can have multiple irregular iris domes. These patients will not have a very high pressure, and they will not respond to a YAG peripheral iridotomy because the oil will not come out. So in these patients, one has to go in again and remove the oil by suction. There's a higher incidence of cistern macular edema. It's important to have an early dilated retinal examination at the baseline. So immediately afterwards, within the first week, you must have an early dilated retinal examination, see what the fundus is like, and do a baseline post-op OCT. You can do NDI laser capsulotomy to that plaque about a couple of months down the line, and you must warn all patients who have a post-vitrectomy cataract that they will need an NDI laser capsulotomy almost immediately after the cataract surgery. Also, there's a higher risk of retinal detachment or IOL subluxation in the late postoperative period. So hence, one must use a customized approach, have an experienced cataract surgeon, have a close communication with a vitreoretinal colleague. And in many of these patients, almost 90% of patients, the vision improves from what it is just now, but it never may achieve 6-6, N6, the way the cataract surgery normally does. So you have to warn the patient about it. Thank you.